Lord God, unto you, Jesus Christ, and unto you, the Holy Spirit. In all these things, we bow and we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please join in our song this morning, Who Am I?
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am yours, I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me me rise again? Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. Because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am.
Please join me in the call to worship. Lord, may we approach the throne of grace with humble boldness. Jesus sympathizes with our weaknesses. We will find mercy and help in our time of need. Please be seated and join me in the prayer of confession. Living God, it is easy to become discouraged. Our confidence is quickly shaken. Our faith is fragile as a reed in a storm. When we falter, remind us that we are your beloved children, sisters and brothers with Christ. Teach us anew what you have chosen us as the first fruits for salvation through sanctification in the Spirit. Comfort and strengthen us. Give us strength to stand firm and hold fast, that we may do every good work in your name. Amen. Please take a moment of silence to yield to the Holy Spirit, but also to speak to the Lord God Almighty on your own behalf. Holy Father, you read each heart that is here, not in spoken words, but in unspoken words. And we lift them all before you, Lord, because we know you are attentive to the words of our heart. And for that we thank you, O Lord. Hear these words of assurance. Take courage. God is with us. God's Spirit abides among us. Life is filled with the riches of God's blessings. God's Spirit renews our lives. With God, all things are possible. God's Spirit makes us whole. Please join in the Gloria Patri. Please be seated. Do we have any upper room touches this week that you have read and it touched your heart and spoke to you? Do we have any testimonies this morning of what God did this week in your lives or in the life of a friend of yours?
Oh. So we had a prayer and we talked about it and she thanked me for that.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that is amazing when God uses us in when we're least expected. And it is really cool when God does that. So anything else this morning?
I'm thankful God was watching over me last Sunday. I was in a car accident somewhere last week on my way to work. And the guy that hit me got out of his car, looked down at me down the street, and got back in at the top. So I have no idea where he went to. The house that happened in front of the man came out, and he was able to witness to the police what happened. I'm just thankful it wasn't any worse than what it was.
Praise the Lord. Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. Well, if you don't have insurance, you run away quite quickly. So. Okay, this morning then. We might get out of church really early today. Okay. So our scripture is on James. And James was something that one day I was in Bible study. And I was in Bible study. It led me to James 5. And I decided that James 5 was for the church because I felt God was impressing me upon me that this was for the congregation. Number one, it was to encourage us. Number two, it was to tell us that God has this in his hands. And so we're supposed to rely upon God and not worry about it. And we do a lot of that. We do a lot of worrying about it. So it's actually in three different sections almost. And so I'm going to read the first one. In the first one, it starts out, now, come you rich people. Now, that is not just talking about people that have money. This is people that have money that oppress other people because they have money. If we've looked in our nation lately, we believe that there are a lot of people in our higher upperry that is actually oppressing the lower people. And some of them they even call names because they're not of the same class that they are. So the first part is what God is going to do with them, not what we're going to do with them. It's about God sees this and God knows this and God has a plan for them, a plan that we cannot carry out. It is only a plan that God will carry it out and he will carry it out perfectly. So we don't fully have to understand everything what's going on, but we know that God's hand is in this and he will deal with them. Come now, you rich, weep and wail for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted and your clothes are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have rusted and their rust will be evidence against you. It will eat your flesh like a fire. You have laid up your treasures for the last days. Listen, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in wealth and luxury and in pleasure. You have fattened your hearts in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the righteous one who does not resist you. Does that sound like our land now? Does it sound like the people that we know that are controlling everything around the world? Those that are rich and those that are powerful and those that just want money. How much money is enough? How much wealth is enough? God sees they are living in the lap of luxury, and there's nothing wrong with living in the lap of luxury. The part that's wrong is they have oppressed people. And that's what they have done. They have taken the money away from the people, and they've put it in their own pockets. And they've lived very well. And their attitude, if you're not like them, you're not any good. Are we being oppressed by them? Yes, we are. Does God know that? Yes, He does. What is the worst thing you can possibly do to a rich person? Empty out his bank account. Make his silver and gold absolutely worth nothing. Take all the riches that are out there that they claim that they are theirs. May their boat sink out into the ocean. May everything that they drive start to fall apart. When your whole... Rachel.
Some people are so poor, all they have is money, and they
their, yes, yeah. Well, and that's all they look at. Is that's the whole thing their life is about. Those that are oppressing others and walking on them do not know the Lord God. They do not know Jesus Christ. That's truth. That's all they have is money. But what happens when the money is taken away? When it's all gone? James, they have absolutely nothing. And you try to take their money away from them and you will have a fight on your hands. But God does it in such a way that they will not even know that it's being done. That He is the one that is in charge here. He is the one that says, don't you try to take them on. You let me. And you watch. You watch and see. Because I have your back. I am for you. And those that oppress others are using the works of the devil to do that. But the promise is here for us. Is because we've sat around tables in our kitchen and here in the dining room, and we've discussed what can we possibly do? How can we stop this? How can we change this world around? God is saying, I will take care of this. You praise and worship me. That's where you at. You send your prayers up. You praise and worship me. And even for those that are being the oppressor, say a prayer for them. That they might come to know the true riches that you already have. And that is Jesus Christ. Is there anybody praying for them? I would say not. When God asked me to pray for George Soros, was not exactly what I wanted to do. But like Rachel says, his whole life is tied up in money and in power and in authority. Where is love? Loving money isn't love. It's called greed. Where is the love in the oppressor's hearts? We need to pray for the enemy. He tells us that. Pray for the enemy. In the next part of this, he also talks to us. And I love the word that he gives us. Be patient. Be patient. God is not finished yet. Therefore, beloved. Imagine God standing up here this morning, or Christ here, and proclaiming to you this morning, you are my beloved. It is for you that I will deal with the oppressors, but you are my beloved. James is still more about us than it is about the oppressors. He says, be patient. Be patient. Give it to me. Let me hold it and carry it. You just be patient. You settle in until the coming of the Lord. And again, we see in Scripture, the farmer waits for the precious crop of the earth, being patient until it receives the early and the latter rains. Patience is not one of our greatest qualities. We've been taught we have to do something. We've got to fix this. And there's just things that we need to admit in our own hearts. We cannot fix it. We cannot. But I can rest in the Lord God that He can and that He will. Because Jesus is coming back one day and everything will change totally and completely. And that's what we're to be patient for. Wait for His coming. Keep your eyes on him, not on the oppressors. Keep your eyes on him. And patience must be something that he really wants us to work on, because you also must be patient. Twice he tells us in two verses, be patient. How many of us have prayed for patience? And how many of us has turned around and said something that we shouldn't have, even after we just got done praying for patience? Is patience something that you have to kind of work at? Yeah, it is. And you know that little voice inside of you that says that wasn't what you were supposed to be doing? That's the Holy Spirit telling you how to be patient. Because there's some things that I do, and I don't like being upset some days. And I'll keep saying, Lord, I have to give it back to you because I don't want that. I want to feel the joy of the Lord. I want to be patient. I don't want this thing over here that bugs me all the time. I just don't want it, and I don't need it. But I need to be patient and let the voice that's telling me to be patient say, okay, Lord, it's your turn. Be patient. Beloved, do not grumble. Wow. Do not grumble against one another so that you may not be judged. See, the judge is standing at the doors. We all grumble. We all complain. But our heart should be towards worship and praise. And our thought should be, God has this. I don't have to do this. I don't have to pick this up and take it. God already has this. I can rest secure in him. And I can enjoy life. Because I never heard anybody that grumbled that was happy when they were grumbling. Never have. Not even me. And we find it's much easier to grumble than it is to compliment. We should look more for complimenting somebody and encouraging and leave the grumbling behind. I fit in this just as well as everybody else does. And he asks us to watch and see. As an example, look at the suffering and the patience, beloved, of the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Indeed, we are called and blessed by those who showed endurance. You have heard the endurance of Job. You have seen the purpose of the Lord and how the Lord is compassionate and mercy. Job lost absolutely everything, friends and all. Job still clung to the Lord, and God replaced absolutely everything that he lost twofold. Job's life would not have been easy to lose his whole family. To lose everybody that counted. And I don't know how you feel about replacing that with another family. But God was compassionate and merciful on Job. And he used Job, actually, to defeat the enemy. An amazing thing. But watch, he showed endurance. And above all, my beloved, do not swear either by heaven or by earth, nor any other oath. Let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. Do not swear by a grave. Do not swear by Washington, D.C. Do not swear by anything. Just yes or no makes it perfect and makes it right. That is your choice. All of these have been wonderful things that God is telling us, that he's going to take care of this. He's telling us also to be patient and wait. Just to watch. But to also, when you see something happen, tell others. Tell them that you have watched the hand of God work in a car accident that doesn't happen. You know, one that that it's close and nobody was hurt. That is by the hand and the grace of God. A deer ran out this morning. By the hand and grace of God, I didn't hit him. That is what we are supposed to be sharing, how God is touched. But if you look on the back of your bulletins, the next part is amazing of what we are supposed to be doing also. We always have a question in our mind, God, what should we do? What should we do? Look at the back of your bulletins. I don't know if I'll read them exactly in the order that they are. So, all my beloved, do not swear. Got that one. Verse 13. Are any among you suffering? Question. Are any of you suffering? The answer for here is, then pray. Pretty easy answer, is it not? If you're suffering, then you should pray. Is any of you here cheerful? Are you happy and are you glad? Are you glad to be here this morning? And it says, then you should sing praises because you already have the melody in your heart. You're already singing. You're just not singing loud. Are any of you sick? And we've done this many times. And many times people have left here healed. And we've re-prayed for them. And that works. You don't have to do it one time and that's it. You can do it as many times as your body wants to walk up here and to be prayed for. Are any of you sick? They should call for the elders of the church. Who are the elders? Anybody that's in a position here is an elder of the church. I don't think you have to have a title, elder. But if you belong to the body of Christ, you are an elder. You are the ones that are come up and help pray for others. Because there's mighty power in the number of people that come and believe what God is doing. You should call the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. Please note that doesn't just mean pastor. That means any of you can anoint with oil. It means any of you can pray. Not just me, but the whole body of Christ. Your prayers can be more valuable than mine because it's coming from a different place and God is using you. If you are thinking about praying, that's because God has put that in your heart. So don't tell him no. Don't tell him no. Pray for that person that is up here. Pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. For the prayer of faith, have to have faith. We have to believe God will do what he says he's going to do. We'll save the sick and the Lord will raise him up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. A whole life brand new and different. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. How many times have we confessed our sins to anybody else other than God? How many times have we asked somebody to pray for us because our sins are getting in the way? And we need their word from the Lord to pray over us? The other day I did ask a lady to pray for me and I confessed a sin before her. And it wasn't easy, I agree, because we have to admit our faults. But she was faithful, and she prayed for me. And in return, she confessed her sins to me. And I had the privilege of praying for her. And there was a release in that, and a wholeness in that. So don't be afraid to confess your sin to somebody else. I wouldn't confess it to everybody, but someone that the Lord is bringing in that he wants you to tell what is really weighing your heart down. For that, we confess our sins to one another. And the prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. We studied about Elijah. Elijah was a human being like us. He prayed fervently that it did not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. I admit, we would have a very difficult time praying that it didn't rain for 3.5 years. But God hasn't asked us to do that either. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. When we, I'm going to say, interfere in other people's lives, that we know that they need the Lord Jesus Christ, we start that out with prayer before we even see them. We pray for them, Lord, make a way, make an opening, that I may be of service to them, that they may come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That will change their life completely, but it'll change it for joy and gladness. It'll take away the heaviness that they are under and the burden that they are under. And I know I have used them over and over again, but I don't have a better example than Derek and April, who lived in a garage with no running water, who lived on the street and stole almost everything so they could have drugs. And God brought us together. I'm not saying it was me. I'm saying God brought us together with a lot of other people. And those two are now, they are now teaching other people how to come to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Their sins are forgiven, and there were many of them. Many of them. And God washed them all clean. The same thing he did to us. We had many sins before we went before the Lord. And let's face it, we still sin. And we need to come before the Lord again and again. And he says, no, I've counted. You've met your limit. I won't forgive him anymore. That's not our God. Not our God. He forgives our sins. We must also help forgive the sins of others, but pray for them. God has sent this word this morning. He will take care of the oppressors. Be patient and wait, for the Lord is coming. But in the meantime, be the church. Pray for one another. Anoint one another with oil. Celebrate with each other that you belong to the Lord God. That heaven's gates are going to be flung open wide when you get there. Because your name is already written in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is a group of people that love the Lord Jesus Christ. And in that, we all celebrate together. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you come and you visit us here in this place. You come with the Holy Spirit and you touch each and every life individually. As a group, but individually, you have touched each one here this morning. Lord, we ask, O Lord, that you would just help us to understand your word greaterly, but that it will just touch us and renew us and revive us, but also that you will place a song within our hearts that we can sing and worship and praise in adoration you, the Lord God Almighty, who set it all about, and in our precious Lord Jesus Christ. In his name, we pray all these things. In the name of Christ, amen. Please turn in your hymnals or on the screen. 454, open my eyes that I may see. Please be seated. Is there any joys and concerns for today? We have Pam down and Bev for the One for Salvation and Monica and anybody else? Tyler? Oh, okay.
I'd like to put the Jensen family on the prayer list. Tim and Susie Jensen lost their son and his girlfriend to the first day of Friday night car accident in Nebraska. And they're going to need lots and lots of support. Tyler, a brother and his dad, Tim, were at the Carolyn Claw.
Oh, that's Tim Jensen? We might try something a little bit different here sometimes because I don't get it all straight when I can't write as fast. So I might ask you to kind of just bring it in and I'll put some little pieces of paper back there and you can bring it up with the offering or sometime. I don't know. We'll get them up here so you know. James. I can't hear that. Oh, Penny. Okay. Okay. I have the Tim Jensen and that Susie is Tim and
Tim and Susie Jensen.
Yeah. Yeah. Tenson, not Jensen. Okay. All right. Yeah. See if I write. Okay. We're gonna go the other route. Okay. Anything else this morning? Okay. Okay. Would you like to be anointed with oil this morning and prayed for? Okay, we can do that. Anything else this morning?
We do have a couple of birthday girls in the audience today. Ray was on the 19th and Jeremy's on the 24th.
Okay. Jessica, you want to do it? Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you. May you feel Jesus near every day of the year. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. God bless you throughout the year. I'm going to say these and then we'll have Jim come up at last. And anybody that wants to come up is welcome to come up and lay hands on him and pray. Okay? All right. I praise the Lord. Donnie is walking with a cane and doing really well. So, yeah. So he was trying to reteach himself how to walk this morning. So, all right. Anything else now this morning? Yes.
Thank the Lord for sending all the people to Peaceful Hospital to get vaccinated. So far, they have vaccinated about 500 people in the last week and a half.
They got me, too. I got a Friday.
Cool.
I believe by doing this vaccination, we can
go back. Yeah. Yep. So. Yeah, and please, when you're praying about this, please pray that the vaccine itself is safe. Okay, so that God will be in on that also. Okay. All right. Let's go to the prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, as we come before you as the body of Christ, we are in one accord. We are gathered together in the same place, O Lord. And we support each other in our prayers to you, O Lord. As we come before you, Lord, there are those things upon our hearts that we lift up now silently to you. Heavenly Father, I thank you. for your watching over both of Pam and Monica, Lord, that their cars are probably not in very good shape, but they are, Lord. We thank you for your hand of presence there with them. We pray for the lady that Bev talked to in the nursing home, oh Lord, about salvation, Lord. We just ask that your light will just shine within her, that she will know without a doubt that she is a child of a living God, that her whole countenance will change, because you tell us when we come to you, we are a new creation in Christ Jesus, Lord. So make her a new creation, Lord, one that is settled, but one that has a joy and a light within her. We also pray for Tyler, Lord. You know all about him. You know where the health needs to be, O Lord. We would ask, Lord, that you would encourage him to come to church, that we might lay hands on him and pray for him. Because the prayers of the righteous availeth much, Lord. So we ask, Lord, that you will do that you'll bring him here, that we might pray for him before you. And we pray for the Tim Tenson family and Susie, Lord, that have lost a son and a girlfriend or daughter-in-law, girlfriend. Lord, for both families that are involved here, bring your body of Christ around them just to be there for them, but to lift them up also before your throne, because you know what it's like to lose a family one, Lord. We ask, O Lord God, for strength for them, for your peace to settle in around them, to enclose them, that they know that they are in the presence of you, the Lord God Almighty, that the presence of Christ is with them. And for all the people that come, O Lord, that come, may they be gracious and humble before them. May they enter in exactly at the same time that they need, but not stay too long either for the overwhelmingness. Lord, we place them in your hands. We thank you, Lord, for all the vaccines that are available for COVID-19, Lord. We just pray that there will be health there and wholeness there, and the vaccines, Lord, and in the people, that your hand will be upon them also, your healing presence there. We pray for Penny, O Lord, and you know all about Penny, Lord. I don't have to know anything. I just know that we can bring her before your throne of grace and stand her before you, the Lord God Almighty. And you will reach out your hand and you will touch her, Lord. And you will speak with her heart. And you will call on to her, Penny, come home. Come home to where love is and grace and mercy. Lord, call. Help her. Help her to answer you in the name of Christ. We pray all these things, O Lord. I would ask Jim to please come forward now as I anoint him with oil. I will ask again, when we're up here, if the Lord has put a word upon your heart to share, please share that word, because that is needed here in this place. It is needed for Jim. We are to pray for one another. We pray in the name of the Lord. We anoint with oil. We pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, you know this man. You've known him for a long, long time. You know his body. You know all the things that are going on in there, Lord. We ask, O Lord, for thy healing touch to be upon him. But we ask for the greater part, Lord, that thy presence just fills him, just engulfs him, so that when he rests secure in your, in you, O Lord, and he's at full peace with whatever happens, Lord. He is yours. But we do pray the prayer of Christ. He is our healer and our keeper. And we ask, O Lord, thy healing touch to be upon him. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Joy.
And joy, O Lord. Amazing joy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings of this family. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless.
Thank you.
Okay. At this time, we will receive our gifts and our offerings. Okay, we're done.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not
from your hands, O Father, we receive. From your hands you gave us. And from our hands, O Lord, we give it back unto you, that you will use it mightily to place it in other hands that worship the Lord Jesus Christ, that honor you, the Lord God Almighty, and is filled with the Holy Spirit, Lord. We thank you. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, amen. Thank you. Please turn to 368. My hope is built on nothing less. Go in the grace and the peace and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. From the scriptures this morning, the first one says, I've got this. I've got this. The second one, it says, be patient. Wait for his coming. Be patient. And the third one says, be the church. Be the beloved church that he has created and made to be a light in this world. We are to go from here fully knowing that he's got this. He has this. We need to know that we need to be patient again. Okay? But we also need to know that we are his beloved light. So go with the fascination and the excitement of belonging to the Lord God Almighty. In his name we pray, hallelujah and amen. God bless.